Hello, my name is Jonathan Broadwell, and I'm an embedded systems consultant and medical device development consultant at my company, Broadwell Consulting Incorporated. And as of July of 2024, I have some capacity if you need help with an embedded systems project or other project. I also do a fair amount of work in Fusion 360, which is going to be the purpose of this video. I'm available as well to help develop custom Fusion components if you need help in that area. So, today we're going to take a look at a part that I got on AliExpress. I bought them. They seem cool. I have no data sheets. I have nothing on this part. So how do we create it and integrate it into a design? In this series of videos, we're going to walk through all of the steps to take this part that we know nothing about and fully build a 3D model, make a footprint, make a schematic symbol, make a schematic, and then integrate that into a printed circuit board. Send that printed circuit board off for manufacture, as well as put in place and bill of materials, and we'll have some of the components added at manufacturing for that. Then we'll get the boards back and we will 3D print them into a case and finally connect to the part over Arduino so that we can show it works in software. And each of these will be different videos. These videos are still being edited and will be released over time, so definitely hit the subscribe button so that you can get a notification when each of these steps comes out. So let's get started with that now. One of the things that my Serial Wombat project is really good at is creating user interfaces. And when I saw this switch that goes up, down, and select, I thought, boy, that could be really useful. And I said, okay, so let's get this in and let's build it into a design. The first step for that is let's build up a 3D model. That'll help us create the footprint later, and then we can integrate it into a PCB in the future. So let's take this part. The first thing that we're going to do is scan it at 1000 DPI, and we'll take that scan and import it into Fusion as a canvas. When we scan things, I always put a ruler next to them so that I have a length reference that I can use in Fusion to get the scaling proper. In Fusion, we'll start a new design and we'll go to Insert Canvas to put our scan into a sketch. We'll select the plane we want the sketch to be on and hit OK. Now we'll right-click on it and say Edit Canvas. This will give us the option to flip it horizontally. This is important because we're actually looking at the bottom of the part and we want to be sure that we project it in the right direction. Now we're going to calibrate by clicking two places on the ruler and telling it how far apart those parts should be. At that point, Fusion will automatically scale the canvas in order to be the right units relative to the rest of our drawing. It's unlikely that our part was oriented exactly perfectly on the scanner bed. And we can see here that there's a slight angle, that things that should be horizontal are not. And so we're going to play with the angles a little bit and zoom in until we think that we've got this part scan perfectly horizontal. That looks good. Now let's move the part to the origin so it's properly centered. We're going to select the center of those three pads right there and call that the origin part for our point for our part. That looks good. Now let's create a new component where we're going to build the actual 3D model. We'll make that an external component because we're actually going to throw this design away because we're not going to want to store this canvas information forever. Now let's create a new sketch on the XY plane and we'll start outlining the component. This component is symmetrical across the y-axis, so we're only going to draw half of it, and then we'll use the mirror command to complete it. we'll simplify some of the details, such as those little notches that aren't going to have any impact in how we use the part. Then we'll use the mirror command to create a complete profile. We'll mirror across the y-axis. Off camera, I just measured the height of the body of this part, and it was 2.5 millimeters. So we're going to extrude this body up that high. Now we have a 3D part. Now we'll flip the part over and model the pads. They're pretty much flush with the part, so we'll make a 0.1 millimeter indent into the part and then model them back up. We're definitely going to want these on a sketch because we're going to use these later in order to create the footprint. We're making the pads new bodies. That way we'll be able to add a steelish appearance to them after they're complete. To be nice and neat, we're going to go in and rename all of those bodies as pads, and then we'll create a group for them. We don't know what this part is exactly made out of, so we're going to call the body ABS. We're going to make it black, but we won't make the black all zeros. We'll make it about 25s so that it has a little bit of a reflection to it. Now, without creating a sketch, we're just going to extrude the top profile of the body up by 0.1 millimeter, and we'll create a new body so that we can give that a steelish appearance as well to match the part. Now, the most critical part of the model. We're going to draw a couple of circles on the bottoms that correspond with the little posts that come out of the bottom of the part. Those posts are used to help position the part in holes on the PCB. So they have to be perfect. They need to be perfectly centered, plus or minus a little bit of tolerance, and they need to be the right size, too small, and the part will move around more than we want inside of the PCB, too big, and it won't fit at all. So we're going to very carefully try to dimension these. The three-point circle tool is a great way to draw circles over existing drawings. We don't know down to the hundredth of a millimeter what this dimension is supposed to be, but we're going to go ahead and define one. Because if we have to do a second revision of the PCB later, we're going to want to be able to precisely define exactly what size we want those holes based on the part that comes back and if it needs to be bigger or smaller. Another off-camera measurement with my calipers shows that these are 0.7 millimeters high. So we're going to extrude these out as part of the main body, 0.7 millimeters. I hope I never lose that feeling of wonder when you first start seeing a 3D part on your screen and you say, boy, that really looks like the real life object in my hand. Next, let's figure out how to model the thumb wheel. And we're going to create a plane that is halfway, a mid-plane between the top and the bottom. And then we'll create a profile sketch of the knob, and we will do a symmetrical extrude up and down based on the thickness of that knob. In this case, we're going to keep things simple just by making the knob an extension of the main body. If we wanted to do it in a little more complicated way, we could make the knob a second component and create a revolving joint to the main body that would limit how far the knob would move back and forth. That could potentially be useful later for checking for interferences to make sure that the knob could move through its full range of motion. Now that we've drawn the profile, we're going to do a symmetric extrude based on a distance of 1.5 millimeters that I measured again with the calipers on the sample part. Finally, I'll save the assembly, and when I do that, then it'll save the external component. Then I'll go back and delete the assembly, leaving only the external component, which does not store the canvas image that we don't necessarily want cluttering up our future designs. In our next video, we'll create a schematic symbol for this part based on an evaluation of how it works using a multimeter. Hit like if you like this video, if you'd like to see some more, and definitely subscribe as the next videos in this series will be coming out shortly. You'll definitely want to get notifications on those to help you build your electronic parts. And again, if you need help with a project of any sort, contact me at broadwell.consulting. Broadwell Consulting Incorporated provides help developing medical devices with a focus on developing embedded firmware, which is compliant with IEC 62304, ISO 14971, and ISO 13485, as well as remediation assistance for products already in production. For more information, contact John at Broadwell Consulting. Support requests for Serial Wombat should be sent to help@serialwombat.com and will be answered on an as-available basis. Also, feel free to leave your question in the comments below.